invite you to take out your Bibles this morning as I'm going to begin a short series of sermons in the month of November. The name of the series is The Art of Thanksgiving. And we're going to look at three R's. This morning we're going to look at the art of recognition. Next week we're going to look at the art of reception or receiving. And then the last week before Thanksgiving, we're going to look at the art of response. How do we recognize, how do we receive, and how do we respond? And then on Thanksgiving Day, we're going to do that. We're going to respond with thanksgiving and gratitude. And so this morning, we're going to look at the art of recognition. And the text that I chose for this morning's message comes to us from Psalm 144. And so I invite you to take out your Bibles and turn with me to that passage, Psalm 144. And we're going to look at the first eight verses. On the third week, the art of response, we're going to look at the last half of Psalm 144, and next week we're going to look at another psalm. And so please stand as we hear the word of the Lord, and again as if you are able, and again as we conclude, if you would respond with the words, thanks be to God. Hear then these words from the Lord from Psalm 144, the first eight verses. Praise be to the Lord, my rock, who trains my hands for war, my fingers for battle. He is my loving God and my fortress, my stronghold and my deliverer, my shield in whom I take refuge, who subdues peoples under me. O Lord, what is man that you care for him, and the son of man that you think of him? For man is like a breath, his days are like a fleeting shadow. Part your heavens, O Lord, and come down. Touch the mountains so that they smoke. Send forth lightning and scatter the enemies. Shoot your arrows and rout them. Reach down your hand from on high and deliver me and rescue me from the mighty waters, from the hands of foreigners whose mouths are full of lies, whose right hands are deceitful. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. The art of recognition. Recognition is a very important part of our life. And Kay and I have been here officially now 1 month today. And so I'm glad to say that, to let you know that nobody has asked us to leave yet. And we really have no desire to leave yet. So that we've made the first 30 days. But the art of recognition is important when you come into a new place. And so it's good for me to look out into the congregation and see some faces that I recognize. Not only because I've seen you several times, I've seen your faces, but also I've had a conversation with many of you, and I look forward to having conversations with all of you so that I get to know you and am able to recognize you more clearly. The same is true for when you're driving around. We haven't gotten lost too many times in Stephenville, but there are a number of times where we've gotten lost. We don't recognize landmarks. We have no connections or ties to many of the places and businesses and things that are in Stephenville. And so we sort of wander around, and you may laugh at the way, if we told you how we got someplace, you may laugh and say, really, you took that way? Well, we made it to every place that we've had to make it to. But recognizing things, landmarks, people makes life so much easier. And so as God's people, we are called to be people of gratitude, people of thanksgiving, people of joy. And so for us to be those kind of people, we need to recognize why and who makes us joyful. Why and who makes us thankful? Why and who is the reason that we call ourselves Christians? And so David, in this psalm, points out his recognition of the one he is grateful for, the one he is thankful to. And so as I go through this message this morning, we're going to look at recognizing the one who makes us joyful and thankful, recognizing who we are as people that need help to be thankful, and recognizing the one who wants us to not be thankful, the one who wants to remove joy from our life. And so when we recognize those three things, it's going to be much easier and much more doable to be thankful. And so the first thing I want us to look at is to recognize who this is that David is talking to, who he is praising. And he says, "Praise be to the Lord, my rock." Now, I don't know if this part of Texas has rocks. But if you go to Israel, there are rocks everywhere. And you drive the countryside and you see rock piles and rock fences. And all these rocks have been picked up from the soil, but yet the soil is very, very fertile, and it will grow things as long as they can get the rocks removed. And so the people of Israel knew what it was to have rocks. Rocks were part of their day-to-day life. And so when David says, "You are my Lord, my rock," first thing that they would think of is when you walk out in the desert and the heat is oppressive and you're looking for a place that seems to offer shelter or a place where life can exist in the desert, all you have to do is look for a rock, and on the leeward side, on the side that the sun doesn't hit it, there is a little bit of shade. And it doesn't dry the desert out quite as much, and there is life growing. There is something green growing in the sand. And if the rock is big enough, the sheep will lay down in the shade of the rock. And if you're traveling the desert and you need a place to rest, if you find a big enough rock and you lay and put yourself on the right side of the rock where the sun isn't shining, you can find a shade, a place to find rest. David is saying, "You are my rest. You are the place where I can find life in the middle of a desert where there is no life." Also, they would also think of, David would be thinking of the fact that when he was being chased by King Saul, he was hiding. He had been anointed king by Samuel, you'll remember, as a little boy, a shepherd boy, and he had been called in, the last of his brothers, the runt of the litter, and his dad says, "I got one more son, but you really don't want to see him. He's the littlest one, and he's out taking care of the sheep." And Samuel said, "Call him in." And so when Samuel saw him, the Lord said, "This is the one." And so he anointed him king. But David was a shepherd yet, and he was anointed king, but Saul was officially the king. And so once Saul figured out that David was going to replace him, he wanted to kill him. And so he hid amongst the rocks and the caves. He found safety amongst the rocks. And finally, the rocks were used to build. They were the foundation. They would set their structures and build their walls and their buildings on the rock. The Bible talks about build your house on the rock and not on the sand, because the sand is unstable. And so it was a place of stability, a place of shelter, a place of hiding, a place of rest. So David recognizes that God is his rock. He also calls him his fortress. Now, we don't live in a day where we have fortresses. When we drove into Stephenville, when we came here, we didn't have to stop at the city gate and ask for permission to enter so someone would roll the gates open to let us in. We don't live in fortified cities. Yes, we have police forces, and we have security and cameras, and we have all the things that we use for security, but we don't have fortified cities. In David's day, in the time that he wrote, there was fortresses. A fortress was an impenetrable structure, a place where people could not enter and simply pass through. you couldn't just drive through Stephenville. You had to go around the wall if Stephenville is fortified. In the same way, David is talking about the enemy, where the enemy cannot simply come into our life and Psalm 1 says, do not sit, stand, or walk with the enemy. So David is saying, as our fortress, God makes it possible so that the enemy cannot penetrate, cannot come into our life, and cannot simply stand, walk, and sit with us. Because if he does, if he's able to do that, he's going to have an influence. And so he's our fortress. He's our place of defense, sort of like an eagle's nest. An eagle builds his nest high in the tree where nobody else can get there. She protects her young. God is our fortress, our protector. And if you were to look at the Hebrew word, the ancient Hebrew word, the root of the word fortress is to come alongside, to lay beside. And so David would remember when he was a shepherd. And he would gather his sheep at night, and he would, many times for shelter, they would bring him into the cave, and the cave would have a small opening, and the shepherd, David, would lay at the entrance to the cave. He would lay alongside of his sheep, providing a fortress, a safe place for them. He would literally lay his life down to protect his sheep. And so David knew that God would do the same thing for him, that he would guard the gate, that he would protect him from the enemy, just as he did from Goliath. He also says that God is his stronghold. Now, oftentimes we think of strongholds as things that are strong that we can always depend upon. But in this case, the stronghold that David is talking about is the power of influence. And so, as is the case with the people that are involved with Crossroads Prison Ministries, those who have been incarcerated, the influence on their life, the power of influence, has led them to actions that have caused them to become prisoners. And the Bible tells us that unless we walk with God, the power of influence, the one who rules, the one who roams the earth, seeking whom he may devour, is the influence of Satan. And so the stronghold of our life without Christ, without God, is Satan. He's the one who influences us. He's the one who gives us motivation and direction. And so David is saying, God, when he is our stronghold, he is the influence. He is the one who influences us in every way. He's the one who gives us our mindset. He's the one that we are grounded in. Oftentimes I hear people talk about others and say, well, we're talking about young adults or young people and wondering how they're going to go in life and how things are going to go for them. And sometimes I hear people say, well, they're well-grounded. They're well-grounded. They're rooted. Their roots are set firmly. And so their influence is a Christian home. Their influence is a church that they're a part of. They have the influence that they are listening to is godly. And so they are grounded. The wind may blow, the storms of life may come, but they'll be able to stand against them. And so he says, the Lord is my stronghold, and he is my deliverer. All of these things are also mentioned in Psalm 118, but deliver means that there is someone who is going to give them a route of escape, a pathway to get out of the imprisonment that they find themselves in. When I was a young boy, I loved to read stories about the Civil War and the Underground Railroad. The Underground Railroad that linked people together so that slaves could find freedom in the North, and they would be transported and moved about from home to home, place to place, until they were able to find themselves in the North where slavery was not allowed. They had a route of escape. There was a place and a plan that they could follow that would give them safety, escape. And so God gives us a plan, a route, a place where we can find escape. David knew that. And so because God does all these things, he is the one that we should give thanks for. Now we look at our life and we see all of these blessings that we have. We have homes, we have jobs, we are successful, we have children, we have schools, we live in a country where most of us are affluent. Now, those are all wonderful blessings, but the greatest blessing, the greatest reason for joy that we have is that God is our rock, our fortress, our stronghold, our deliverer. Without that, all of these other blessings would be meaningless. All of these other blessings would be fruitless. And then the psalmist recognizes that there is a middleman, a man in the middle. You know, when you talk about business, we talk about the fact that there's always this middleman, and we want to avoid the middleman because the middleman is always there and putting it in his pocket. Money that should be ours. Things that really we should be able to profit from, and he's taking the profit. Well, the middleman in this story is the man between God, the deliverer, the rock, the fortress, and the enemy, the one who is trying to steal, who is a thief, who is a liar. And so he says, who is man that you care for him? And the son of man that you think of him? Who are we? We're in the middle between evil and good. We're in the middle. And God desires to have us as his own for his glory and praise. Satan desires to have us as his own to take away glory from God and honor that he is worthy and deserving of. And so we are the person in the middle. But who are we? We are weak. We are frail. We are really nothing. And in fact, without the breath of life that God gives us, we turn into dust to be forgotten, to be never noticed again. We think we're strong. We think we can accomplish so many things. We can send man to the moon. We can find cures for cancer. We can develop a vaccine for COVID. We have this digital communication that we can communicate and send pictures and see people all over the world. We're quite something, aren't we? We're pretty special. We're pretty important. And yet, when we compare ourselves to God, we are nothing. And yet God sees fit to love us and to pour out his power and his love into our lives. Even when we aren't willing to receive, or unable to receive, we don't know what to do with it. or even when we misuse his blessings and we come back and say, oh, I lost that. Could you give me another portion? I don't know what I did with it. Could you give me some more? It broke. Could you give me a new one? And we do this daily, and God continues to daily pour his love out for us. And so we are the person in the middle who is actually receiving all of these blessings, all of this love on a daily portion, even though we are undeserving. And then we have to remember that there's someone who is trying to keep us from being grateful. And so if you find yourselves, when you think about November, Thanksgiving, and I hope that Thanksgiving isn't just something that we think about the month of November, but Thanksgiving is something that is part of our life every day. When we think about Thanksgiving, especially in this month and this time of the year, remember that there is someone who doesn't want us to be thankful. And if you aren't finding yourself thankful, if you aren't finding yourself having some joy in your life, you have to ask yourself, who is influencing me? Who has the power of influence in my life? Because if God has the power of influence in my life, I'm going to respond with joy. I'm going to have a reason to be thankful. And every day we have a reason to be thankful. Even if the cow kicked us in the knee and my knee is really sore. Even if I had to go to the doctor because my kidneys aren't functioning properly. Even if I have to put that silly brace on again because I had to have surgery in my back. Or whatever you have in your life, we all have something. But if we allow God to be the influence in our life, if we remember that he is our rock, fortress, deliverer, and stronghold, we have a reason to be happy. But we have to do it in a united front. And so often, Satan divides us. And so we become unhappy. Not because of what God is doing, but because of what someone else is doing. We become unhappy because someone else didn't do something or did do something that upset us. And we let that really dictate our life. Now, Satan wants to divide us, but remember that Satan remains united and that all of his demons, minions, people that are working with him, spirits, they all have one goal and they never lose sight of the goal. And that's to take away glory from God. To take and remove joy from our life. To make us so that people are not thankful. And we see a lot of people in the world like that, don't we? Unthankful people who are looking for something that will give them happiness, but they find themselves bitter and unhappy and miserable in life. I hope that that's not true for any of us. And so David says about these people, they need to be scattered. They cannot be united. They cannot have this united front against us. Scatter the foes. Weaken them. Scatter them. Spread them out so they don't have help. Rout them. My favorite high school football team, the Unity Christian Crusaders of Hudsonville, Michigan, routed their team they played Friday night in the playoffs, much like Stephenville High School routed the team they played, meaning they whooped them, meaning they went home saying, we really didn't got beat tonight. We didn't have a chance. And so rout Satan, so he leaves and says, I don't have a chance. There's no way that I'm going to impact and influence these people of God because God has protected them and blessed them. He's their rock and their deliverer. And so Satan says, I want nothing to do with them. I don't want to go up against them again. And Satan turns and is routed when he hears the name of Jesus. They fear Jesus, and he is the only one they fear. And so if we reflect the love of Jesus, if we reflect and Satan can see in our life that God is present in us, Satan will not come. Now, I have to share this story. It's a true story. It's about one of the members, and I've heard it in multiple churches, but this is a story about one of my members in the church in Michigan. And I've shared it before, but it's a fascinating story, and I believe it. But I believe that this really goes on because in Ephesians 6, Paul tells us that our struggle, our battle is not against flesh and blood. It's not against each other, but it is against the rulers, the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. That's the struggle. And we are the middle, the man in the middle. So the story goes like this. A gentleman drove up to a convenience store, and he was pumping gas, getting gas in his vehicle, and another man pulled up in a rickety old truck, and he had a bunch of bags of cans. In Michigan, all of our aluminum cans, we pay 10 cents deposit on them, and you have to return them to get 10 cents. And so he came with all of his cans to put them through the thing to get his 10 cents per can, and as he drove up, he walked over to this man who was pumping gas, and he says, you're a Christian, aren't you? You're one of those people. And he said, yes, but why do you ask? He said, well, when I drove up, I noticed this light illuminating from you. A light illuminating from me? He said, yeah. I could see light. And he said, you know, I have this light as well. People have told me that I have this light. And the people that tell me tell me that when Satan goes around, when Satan is using people to influence people in a negative way, when they see this light, they avoid those people. Because they know they're strong in their faith. They know that God is their fortress, that God is their deliverer, that he is their stronghold and the rock of their life. And so Satan knows that there's no chance of having any sway or any influence, so they go around. Now, there are a lot of Christians who have a little bit of light, like a candle with the bushel basket over it. You sang the song as kids, right? Hide me under a bushel, no, I'm going to let it shine. There's a lot of Christians like that, and Satan knows that he has a chance with them. Because their light is dimly lit. It's not bright. It's like they're on half power, flickering, barely lit. And so may your light shine bright so that Satan doesn't come and he is routed and he avoids and runs away from you. And then always remember that Satan's weapon is lies and deceit. Promises that he cannot keep. Promises that he has no intention of keeping. but promises that are enticing. Now, if you get online, you see a ton of them, don't you? On Facebook, on social media, all kinds of promises, all kinds of things that say you can have this and this and this and this and this. They're all lies. Many of them are. Unless you know the person that you're talking to, you can probably believe that it's not true. But Satan is an excellent liar, an excellent deceiver, and he never keeps his promise. But we know that God is the one who always keeps his promise. And so would you rather trust someone, depend on someone who is true to his word? Or would you rather put your life in the hands of someone who sorry. I guess I wasn't telling the truth. But you know what? I have something else I want to give to you. Yeah. So, the art of recognition is recognizing who God is, what he has done, what he does and is doing every day, the recognition of who we are, that we do not deserve, that we are weak and frail. Without him, we have nothing. And the art of recognition that there is an enemy that is working against everything that God wants to do. As the person in the middle, who are you going to turn to? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we come this morning. And we pray, Lord, that you may open our eyes, the eyes of our hearts, so that we may recognize you and that we may recognize all that you have done for us and that it may be evident to us each and every day of our life. And as we recognize, may we see clearly who we are, who you are, and how we are so dependent and so needy of your love and grace. And thank you for showing it to us and for giving it to us abundantly and freely. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen.